CCM conference. It's about a 48-year-old male whose chief complaint was dyspnea. So EMCCM conference, today is March 22nd, 2017. I'm Eric Schnitzer, third year. Special thanks to Drs. D'Souza, Kim, and Jared. There was a lot of revisions that needed to be done, so they helped a lot for this. People need to pay attention because I'm going to be asking you guys to basically give me answers so I don't have to talk so much. Juniors. All right, so pre-hospital. So we got a guy came in by EMS. Noted to have tachycardia. Oxygen was applied via face mask. 20-gauge IV catheter was placed. No note of any mention of fluids that were given. Okay, so this is the initial vitals. Heart rate 157, respiratory rate 26, BP's elevated 188 over 125, saturation 100%, as you can see at this point, the patient's on the nasal cannula, and temperature is at 98.8. So initial assessment, ABCs. So airways intact, breathing, patient's tachypneic, mid-20s, with rails going up, circulation, irregular tachycardia is noted. Mental status, the patient appears very anxious. Okay. So junior, I just need like a quick one-liner about, this is a rhythm strip, this wasn't the exact rhythm strip, but if anyone wants to just give a quick one-liner of what that looks like. Donald. Quick one-liner, what does that look like?
It's just tacky, the voltage oscillating in the URS, and it's not very regular.
Okay, so it looks like...
I see PVRs kind of, but I think this is good.
Oh, we can call it a narrow complex, a regular tachycardia. Okay. Okay, so any junior want to give me a problem list? Just a quick problem list of anything that's going on so far.
Shortness of breath.
What else? The rhythm strip showed irregular tachycardia. And then patient's also hypertensive. Okay. So initial problem list, patient dyspneic, tachypneic, AFib with RVR, I was calling it, but we can stick to the narrow complex at this point. Until we get a really EKG and then the patient's hypertensive. So at this point, the initial interventions that were done for the patient was given a 500 ml bolus of normal saline, 15 milligrams of IV diltiazem was given, and then we got an EKG. All right, Donald, I won't call on you again. Does anyone else want to volunteer for this? Charles?
It's kind of hard to tell. Sometimes it's over 300, sometimes it's like...
So fast.
Sorry, I'm over 150.
Yeah. So we got tachycardia. What else?
Irregularly, irregular rhythm, normal axis, can't really see intervals.
Okay, good. So we have an irregular narrow complex tachycardia. So this can either be one of three things. A multifocal atrial tachycardia, which this does not appear to be. There's no regular P waves that are kind of discernible. Or it could be atrial flutter with a variable block, which usually appears as a more regular in intervals where it's not the variable block. So most likely we're going to call this atrial fib with the RVR. Okay. So HBI. So we got 2 to 3 weeks of dyspnea the patient's complaining about. He's also complaining about diarrhea. He's been taking loperamide for this 2 to 3 week process. He's complaining about whole body weakness, leg swelling going all the way up, and palpitations. Review systems otherwise negative. So past medical history, questionable history of whether he had COPD. He was treated once, not really any medical history, doesn't take any medications. No surgical history, no known allergies, and no recent travel. So, social history, patient's a former smoker, unknown family history, it's noted. Any questions up to this point?
I'm sorry, was I not paying attention when you said his age?
48-year-old now. Asian now. That doesn't change anything, it's just what he is.
It's not insulting at all.
It's just what he is. So any questions up to this point about what was presented so far?
Any perspective?
This is is the only history that we know of so far. No recent travel, no family history. He doesn't have any medical history, so it's as far as we know.
Is this the first time we're seeing him? Or is he
first time here. Alright, so now we're going to go on to our physical exam. So the patient appears visually anxious, and there's no visible trauma on the patient. Alright, HENT exam. Pearls noted, mucous membranes are noted to be dry, and the airway is patent. Go to the cardiovascular exam. Patient's tachycardic with the irregular. Decreased breath sounds at the bases with rails, right side greater than left, and JVD is noted on the patient. Abdomen is soft, no mass or abdominal tenderness. Significant scrotal edema is noted on exam. The rest of the skin exam, there's excoriated skin rash on the abdomen and on the extremities, a nonspecific diffuse edema, lower extremity going all the way up to the thighs. So neuro exam, normal neuro exam, patient's alert and oriented with no motor deficits were noted. Okay, any questions so far? What was presented? What?
We don't have a
rectal temperature. We just have 98.8 was the temperature.
It's rashing you?
Don't know. Okay, now back to the juniors. We can get a more extensive differential diagnosis. What's highest up on our differential right now based upon what was presented?
CHF.
So acute heart failure is definitely pretty high up on the list. What else? What? Yeah, it goes along with the heart failure, exactly. What else?
PE,
definitely on the list.
Liver failure?
The liver.
Yeah, that could definitely be causing these symptoms. What else? What?
Tamponade?
Okay. Sepsis, so what's patient called here, dyspnea, so what kind of sepsis? Pneumonia would probably be highest up on the differential, but it could be any kind of infectious symptoms. Alcohol withdrawal or some pathomimetic, any kind of toxidrome could be going on.
Thyroid storm.
Thyroid storm. This is endocrine, right? And then the big vessel coming off of our heart. This could be an aortic dissection as well, right? The only other thing that I added in as possible is myocarditis is definitely something that we have to consider in these patients. Okay? This is a reassessment. This was done after the patient had received the 15 milligrams of diltiazem and the 500 ml bolus. So the vitals were seen to have been improved. BP is 101 over 56, heart rate is 99, respiratory is 20, saturation is 97% on nasal cannula. Okay? So the rest of the ED course, so hospital day zero, still in the ED, patient 60 milligrams PO diltiazem, furosemide 40 milligrams IV, and enalapril 1.25 milligrams. Okay. Shortly after, we get to the patient's bed, the patient's known to have slurred speech. So, Junior, what do you want to do when, first thing you get when you get a patient with slurred speech? The pupils, okay.
Airway.
Fingerstick, right? So fingerstick was done, it was less than 20. D50 was given, mental status immediately improves. Okay, so lab test. I don't want you to just list them off, I want a reason for every one of the lab tests. This isn't a patient that we just, sometimes we just order lab tests for no reason. Every one of the lab tests that were ordered in this patient has a definitive reason, so I'm gonna make you guys work and tell me why you want every one of the lab tests. Saria, what kind of lab tests do you want? Lactate, right? Because we're thinking possible sepsis, right? That could definitely be part of our differential, so a shot panel with lactate, that's good. Tess, what else do you want? Troponin, yeah, because we put myocarditis on our list, so that could definitely be something that we need. Second years. TSH, right? TSH, T4, if we're thinking thyroid storms on our lips.
BNP.
What's that? BNP, right? We're thinking if this is a heart failure patient. Any kind of imaging that you want to do at this point?
Ultrasound.
Ultrasound, right? And then what else do you want?
TFTs.
Yeah, he said. It was said. All right. So we got our list. So CBC, we want to check the patient's anemic at this point, so it's causing some kind of heart failure, like a high output kind of heart failure. CMP, the patient want to look at liver function, we want to check renal function. COAG, so the patient has AFib with RVR, so this patient may be a candidate for anticoagulation, especially if patient's showing hypertensive and heart failure at this point. So based on chats too fast, that would be something that would possibly be in our future that we would think about. TSH, T4, UTOX, we're thinking possible sympathomimetic because we're not getting great history, bedside ultrasound, and then chest radiogram. Okay. So results. So ultrasound. So we got B-lines with no pericardial effusion. There's not really any mention of cardiac squeeze or IVC diameter at this point. Okay. Chest x-ray. So it's a left lower lobe consolidation with pleural effusion. They wrote atelectasis versus pneumonia is the read. Okay, here's the blood gas. Lactate of 2.9. All right, additional blood tests. Miguel, can you tell me what you notice on this blood, panels?
Sure. It has a slight white count.
Okay.
Platelets are slightly increased, but nothing.
So white count's a little increased, but it's on the lower side. What else? Glucose is 13. This was drawn at a similar time to when the finger stick of 20 was noted, so that was already rectified, but this came back a little bit later.
That jumps out a little bit. What else?
Is
that
INR6? Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Schechter.
He's really good.
Yeah.
That's
what representing. No more attending until the end. I will call you guys at the end, though. You guys are going to be needed.
Thanks, so. Gosh.
Yeah, so there's an INR of 6 in this patient, T billy is 3. The BUN creatinine, the ratio is definitely a little bit off. All right, so this is the TSH and the T4, so we're doing our endocrine block. I don't need to tell you this is signs of hyperthyroid at this point. Troponin is negative, so less likely a myocarditis patient. BNP is 686, along with the B-lines, it definitely shows that there's signs of heart failure going on as well. The UAE tox is nothing really remarkable at this point. Okay. So problem list. So if anyone can give us an updated list of what is actually going on in this patient. Now we're narrowing down our differential at this point.
Hyperthyroidism.
So we're going to call it thyroid storm. What else? Back to the x-ray, so possible sepsis from a pneumonia, and then the lab work, INR of 6, so we're going to call it a coagulopathy at this point, and then hypoglycemia. All right, so what do we want to do with all this? We have all this information now. Who are we going to call? What are we going to do? Who do you want to call? What do you want to do?
I'd like to
use propranolol. Propranolol is very
good.
Propranolol fluids. MICU is a good call. MICU would be my first call as well. We can treat all the thyroid stuff on our own. We don't need to call endocrine. But besides propranolol, does anyone else want to give any other medications?
I should have a question about that.
Yeah.
Donald. We've talked about like PTU and stuff like that in the past for thyroid patients, and a lot of attendings have said propanolol first, and we would just give propanolol. Do you have any?
We would just give the what?
Propanolol first, and not give any of like the PTU.
No.
No.
I mean, your attending. attending, I don't want to say any of your attendings, they could do it, but thyroid storm, this is a patient that if you get these patients, you're going to be treating them. Maybe that's like a subacute, the patient you see in Pod A that's kind of looking okay, but a patient like this, you're not waiting for endocrine. At least I wouldn't, I don't think any. Would any attendings wait before giving any other medications? No, I don't think so. At this point, this is a very sick patient. You're calling the MICU and you're acting before, you might call endocrine, which we did, because they're gonna need to be on board, but this is a patient that we're gonna act right now. So besides the propranolol and calling the MICU, any other medications? Antibiotics, yeah, very good. And then any other medications?
Steroids,
very good. So yeah, we'll kind of get to that very quickly, actually. But yeah. All right, so first thing, not the first thing, but in conjunction with everything else, the MICU was called. They recommended vitamin K for this coagulopathy of unknown reason. Okay, so the patient was admitted to the MICU. Obviously, we're going to continue to treat the patient. So vinc, piperacillin, tazobactam is broad spectrum antibiotics. We don't know great history. Maybe it's some kind of more extensive history. If the patient's going to the MICU, this isn't a patient that you really need to narrow the antibiotics at this point for. 100 hydrocortisone, 30 milligrams PO propranolol was given, and 20 milligrams PO methimazole. Okay. All right, so getting back to what Wendy said, a little bit later, maybe an hour after that, patient's BP noted to be 74 over 40. Heart rate is 65, respiratory rate 22, saturation 96%. This is still on the nasal cannula. The patient was immediately given 2 liters of fluid and central access was attempted in both of the femoral veins and both of them were noted to be clotted. Okay. A right internal jugular central vein was, central venous access was placed and norepinephrine drip was started. A little bit later in the course, after receiving the fluids, the patient's respiratory status was known to be in a little bit of distress. BiPAP was tried and the patient didn't tolerate it. There was a lot of discussion with family about possible intubation at this point. Patient was stood up in positioning and thankfully we were able to avoid intubation at this point. So this is definitely a pearl that positioning can help. And if the patient's not tolerating BiPAP, that positioning staved this guy off from getting intubated at this point. Okay. So inpatient course, while patient's still in the ED, endocrine comes, they recommended methimazole, propranolol, cholestyramine, steroids, and IDA. DIC is confirmed and progressing throughout the hospital course. It was confirmed by worsening coagulopathy, worsening platelets throughout the ED, throughout the inpatient course. Okay. There's also noted to be worsening liver function and liver failure throughout the ED. Throughout the inpatient course. So on our labs, when we first got the patient, the bili was already 3, but throughout the course, his LFTs were increasing throughout. On day 4, respiratory distress was noted. PEA arrest with code 99, patient was intubated in the MICU by anesthesia. ROSC was achieved in 14 minutes. Hospital day 6, patient was made comfort care and patient expired. So conclusion, we have thyroid storm, AFib, high output heart failure, possible pneumonia, liver failure, and DIC. So this has been going on for 2 to 3 weeks, so this is pretty extensive from what's been going on, it seems like. He'd already had signs of end organ damage on exam and on lab work by the time he got to the ED. So what next? I want to talk about thyroid storm. I know we've been doing it throughout the course of this block, but a little spaced repetition can't really hurt anyone. Then we're going to talk about heart failure, specifically the difference between high output heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, and heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. And then I'm going to talk to you also about dysrhythmia-induced heart failure. So, oh, Dr. Grishaw, you have a question?
Just another comment on the case. So Wendy brought up about propanolol, but even before that, I have a problem giving an allopurinol IV to someone with blood pressure at the time was 101 over 60. and they have been, you know, getting lower, you know, or may live at a higher blood pressure. I've had experience with IV allopurinol. If their BPs are not very high, I've seen several go become hypotensive. So that would be another medication that I would have questioned at that point, at the one when the pressure is 101 over 60, and then later the BP comes down to 73.
It's also not a great idea to give a medicine that's going to use afterload, because the thyroid hormone is already doing the same thing. I might choose a different medicine. If I were to use anything at all, I might choose a different medicine.
I think at the point that they were giving the LASIK and the enalapril, they were thinking heart failure was highest on the differential. They didn't have back the TSH and T4 at that point.
I don't know about what he was.
Yeah. It was a tough case. Very, very tough case. Anyone else have any questions about the case?
There's a lot of things that I would admit, but it's easier to say it in hindsight. But when I see anybody comes in with AFib RVR, I will wait at least an hour before giving them any medication to drop that heart rate until I can figure out why the heart rate is what it is. Right, so when you are seeing a patient, you want to push that heart rate and bring it down. But there's very often a reason why somebody's in RVR. It's not just a dysrhythmia. And especially somebody who's this sick, there's a lot of things that can be going on that's making the heart rate that fast. So by breaking down the heart rate, a lot of times you can exacerbate whatever it is that's making their pathology happen that's causing the tachycardia. So you should always try to figure out why there's that tachycardia before you treat that tachycardia. And you should make sure that if you're going to give cardizine to somebody for their tachycardia, that the only thing going on with them is a problem with AFib and RVR, and not some underlying systemic process causing that AFib and RVR, which is what the case was in this patient. And they had the biopsy failure, and calcium channel blockers, even more than the beta blockers, are more likely to exacerbate the exacerbation than not.
Along those lines, like your first AFib RVR had a risk of WPW when I was looking at it. So I don't know if it would be
which,
a calcium channel, like your first tachycardia.
The strip wasn't... we didn't have a strip, so I just picked a rhythm strip for AFib.
I also though wouldn't make treatment decisions off that strip. I'd make them off an EKG if I'm going to call some variable thing.
I don't know if I think the EKG may have come before. It's kind of hard to tell the difference. They may have had.
I'm just saying as a principle, like using a strip isn't a reliable representation of what the EKG looks like. So if you're going to make a significant change in your treatment, get the EKG first.
Agreed.
The other thing I just wanted to say, to add to what Justin and anyone had said before, you be also very careful when you add propranolol and calcium channel blockers together. Because they do have, in a way, a synergistic effect. They can both cause bradycardia, they can both cause hypotension, they both can cause decreased output. Ability to contract. You should be careful using both together. Is it an hospital to use it? No, you should have to be very careful.
Any other questions about the case?
No more questions.
All right, so different causes of thyrotoxicosis. So Graves' disease is the most common cause that we're going to see in the ED, but the other causes are multinodular goiter, Hashimoto's thyroiditis, which usually is a hypothyroid, but in the acute phase can cause a hyperthyroid, exogenous T4 that you're taking, infectious thyroiditis, pituitary, or ectopic tumors. So thyrotoxicosis to storm, much like in DKA when we get our patient, we have to figure out why, what actually precipitated it, caused them to go into it. So it's very similar to the causes. So MI, infection, trauma, pregnancy. So these are the same kind of things that we're looking for in DKA. We're going to be doing the same kind of thing in thyroid storm to figure out what caused them to actually go into storm. Whether in this patient it was a pneumonia or wasn't, it was read in the x-rays possible, so that might have been the triggering event. So what's the treatment that we're going to be doing? So we're going to do supportive treatments, so fluids, intubate, pressors as needed. So be a clinical monster, Kings County residents. Okay? Step-by-step process that involves blocking the thyroxine effects, the synthesis, the conversion, the release, and the reabsorption. Okay? So as far as the effects, so propranolol is typically what is cited in the literature for thyroid storm. So 0.5 milligrams to 2 milligrams IV, or 48 to 80 milligrams PO. We may not always have this in our Pyxis, so this is a situation where you have to kind of know your Pyxis and know what kind of medications you have very quickly. But Esmolol, which I think is probably the best medication for these kind of patients. It's a quick on, quick off. You give a 500 mics per kilo bolus, and then you can shut it off very quickly. That may have been, like you guys were saying, where you're afraid to give the medications. This is a medication that can be used and might be a little bit more temporizing, and if you find something different, you can always switch. Okay. Next we're gonna do, we're gonna block the synthesis. So methimazole versus PTU, the guidelines are always kind of changing. I think a lot of the endocrinologists now are kind of switching over to just say methimazole, even in storm, because there are side effects with PTU, agranulocytosis or hepatotoxicity. The only reason we would use PTU is because first trimester pregnancy shouldn't be using methimazole. Thyroid storm, it's said that the PTU blocks the peripheral conversion, the T4 to the T3. So that's another reason why it has been used in the past. So whether you use one or the other, just give one of them, okay? Or an allergy. Okay? The next you're going to be using is steroids. So this is going to be glucocorticoid steroids. This is going to prevent the conversion of T4 to T3 in the periphery. Does anyone remember this guy? I don't know. When I was in med school, this was on all the time, and this is how I remembered the difference between the Drabizdo effect and the Wolff-Chaikoff effect. Does anyone remember the difference? All right. So the Drabizdo effect. So this is like when you go for an angiogram or something like that, you get a big load of iodine, or you can get a big load of amiodarone, and it causes you to actually become hyperthyroid. So you can precipitate storm by sending someone for angioplasty or giving them an amiodarone dose. The Wolff-Chaikoff effect, this is what we're actually trying to achieve during our treatment. So we give the blocking agents, the methimazole or the PTU, and then an hour later, we want to give a large dose of iodine. If after you blocked it, if you give a large dose of iodine, it actually is supposed to suppress the thyroid hormone. That's what we're trying to achieve by giving the potassium iodide. So they use SSKI or Lugol solution, or is a different form of iodine. You probably heard of both of those. Those were given later on in the ICU. It's not as necessary to give right at that moment. The medications that they give were the most important medications, but these medications should be given an hour after the other medications, and it's about 5 drops of each one of them. So lithium. So use as an alternative for patients allergic. I know you're not supposed to be allergic to iodine, but there's all the case reports show that this is supposed to be used in patients that are allergic to iodine. Okay. There's even a case report of patients getting thyroid storm after they had removal from a lithium overdose toxicity. So this is something to consider. If you can't give iodine, then you can give lithium. The next we're going to use is cholestyramine. Cholestyramine works is a prevents the reabsorption of the thyroid. So the way thyroid hormone is broken down, it goes through this enterohepatic circulation. So it gets thrown back into the intestine, and this prevents the thyroid hormone to get reuptaked. Then, if all of that is failing, then we're going to go for our Hail Mary. Hail Mary things that we're going to try. So plasma exchange, plasmapheresis, is something that could be done as a preventative, as a kind of a stopgap before trying ECMO or surgery. So this is something that has been done. There's a lot of case reports that show that it does work. We're not at that stage right now where all the guidelines are saying that this should definitely be used, but it's something that can be used. Now, as with any kind of plasma exchange, there's always risks. So there's coagulopathies that could happen. Patients can become hypocalcemic or infection from this procedure. So it's not without its risks. And in order to do plasma exchange, you have to get big IV catheters, central line catheters. And this patient had an INR6, so you definitely have to be a little bit careful with that. Okay, so ECMO. So there's also case reports of using ECMO. If you saw Dr. Kaufman's lecture, I should say Chief Kaufman's lecture now, ECMO can be used for these kind of patients who are in these dire septic conditions as a stopgap. If all else fails, then surgery. You call ENT and they could perform it, although it's very risky surgery, manipulating the thyroid that's in thyroid storm right now. All right, so overall the morbidity and mortality is 10 to 30% if treated as the mortality. If it's universally fatal if you don't treat it. Okay. It can cause sparse morbidity, it can cause hyperpyrexia, high output heart failure, liver function, coagulopathy, AFib, and neurologic complications. Next, I wanted to go into high output heart failure. So we don't see this very often, so that's why I wanted to kind of go into this case. We need to know how to recognize it, the causes, and the management of it. So as far as recognizing it, so as far as diagnosing someone with heart failure, this is from Martindale's paper, you're going to be using your ultrasound to look for B-lines, you're going to look for signs of fluid overload, you're going to be getting your BNP, that's how you diagnose overload. But in these kind of patients, they're actually having a high cardiac output. So their peripheries are going to be warm, they're going to be having a cardiac output greater than 8, their EF is going to be very good instead of the patients that we get with a systolic heart failure. Okay. This is a slide that I made, or Dr. Kim actually made it, to differentiate the different types of heart failure. So the high output heart failure, so thyroid hormone, when you're in storm, it's thought to induce a vasodilation, so that's why you get this high output heart failure and they get this these problems. The EF is normal in these patients, the cardiac output is high, and overload. When I say overload, I mean signs of fluid overload. Okay, not actually their fluid status, but their signs of fluid overload. Versus the heart failure or preserved ejection fraction, which we some of you guys might know as diastolic heart failure versus high heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, so systolic heart failure. Now, in the high output failure patients, we're going to be using different medications versus our patients with low EF. So in the patients with preserved ejection fraction, these are going to be our patients who come in with the acute pulmonary edema patients. Now these patients we're treating with nitrates, with BiPAP to reduce the preload and afterload, but we're not necessarily giving them Lasix, right? Because not necessarily the overload is just the signs of fluid overload, but they actually might be intravascularly depleted, and it's just a redistribution of the actual fluids. So causes of the high output heart failure. So obesity is a big one, liver function, AV shunts are a big cause, lung disease, myeloproliferative diseases, thyrotoxicosis, beriberi. So this is the wet beriberi when you have a thiamine deficiency. Okay. So management of these patients. So these patients, different from any of the other heart failures, we are going to be using beta blockers in these patients, which isn't typical. It's not the first thing you usually jump to when you have a patient in heart failure, is to jump to giving a beta blocker because we're afraid they're going to drop. I think the best option for these kind of patients is Esmolol. It's a drug that's quick on, quick off. You can keep a quick